I'm Indy Neidell, and this is another exciting episode of The Great War on the Road. And today, I'm at the Deutsche Panzer Museum in Münster. That's the German Tank Museum in Münster. Not Münster. If you go, it's true. They're similar, so don't go to the wrong one if you want to come and visit. Now, we're going to talk today about the A7V, which was the only German-produced tank that saw action during the First World War. And by we, I mean mostly this guy, who's going to tell us about the museum and about the tank and all kinds of really cool, interesting stuff. So can you tell all these people out there in TV land who you are, what you do, and where we are?
Thank you very much. My name is Ralf Ratz, and I'm the director of the German Tank Museum here in Münster, exactly between Hanover and Hamburg. So don't go to Münster, as he said, which is in Westphalia. Beautiful city, visit us, but then come here.
Yeah.
And the German Tank Museum was established in 1983, and we are a joint civilian-military corporation. The museum is run by the little town of Münster, and all the vehicles still belong to the German army, to the Bundeswehr. And we're showing the development of the German armored forces from 1916 till today, basically. That's what we do.
All right, sounds great. So, the A7V.
Yes.
Now, this is a replica of an A7V.
Indeed.
Now, I have to say, because I know if I don't say it, I will actually be killed by all of our Australian fans. There is only one real original A7V that still exists in the world, and it is in Australia. So I'm saying that.
Yeah.
I said it.
And important, they took and they take very good care of it.
Okay.
So that's totally okay. Yeah. They treat it very well, and it's in best hands there.
Now, and what is this one then?
This is a replica, built in the 1980s and 1990s. Took many years to build it. It's very detailed. It's as near to historical accuracy, to perfection, as it can be made based on sources.
Okay.
Photographs, drawings, written memories, and several years were invested to get everything right. I would say 95% are based on sources.
Yeah.
And the last 5% are plausible guesswork. 20 A7V were built, 16 of them got names, and this is Wotan, with the number 563. And what we see is a Wotan of June 1918. The camouflage of the A7Vs changed over the months. They were just in action for half a year, but they got three or four distinct camouflage patterns over these short months. And as I said, this is June 1918. You can see it that you've got two iron crosses on the outside and a Latin numeral in the middle. And that seems early, late summer 1918 always, if
okay.
You see a photo.
Mm-hmm. Now, I have a couple of questions. First of all, okay. What does A7V stand for?
It's ridiculously boring. A7V was exactly the department in the Prussian Ministry of War who organized all the motor transport in the Prussian army. That was A7, the department A7, and V was Verkehr, transportation.
Okay.
So they just called it after the department that was leading the development. That's
now,
it.
When they started developing this,
yes.
They were developing the chassis for these and also
yes.
For some personnel carrying.
Yes, that's
right?
That's the main characteristics of this tank. As you can see, other than the Mark tanks of the British, there are small tracks on the ground. There are no big tracks running around, giving trench crossing capability.
Okay.
And the reason for that is that the German High Command, the OHL, wanted the I-7V to be, on the one side, a fighting vehicle, as we can see here, and then a lorry for transportation of ammunition, of provisions, of troops, anything you needed in the field.
Okay.
So what they wanted was basically the track system and then a flat surface.
Okay, so you could go either way.
Yes, you can put people on it, munitions on it, or you put armor on it, an armored chassis on it. So that's a reason, because this tank always got stuck in the mud with its nose. It's called the low nose problem. You can see it's a very low nose.
Yeah.
And this is because they wanted this flat surface to be available also. So it's a kind of a compromise.
Yeah, they didn't have ending up having the best reputations. I think they're amazing looking. I think it's a really cool looking vehicle.
Yeah.
They only actually built 20 of these.
Yeah.
Were there any other plans for more, or were they? I mean, because that's way behind, of course, Allied tank production.
Am I allowed to say something about the reputation of this vehicle?
Sure.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Because the A7V basically is a sound design.
Okay.
It has not many flaws.
Yeah.
It just has one big flaw in the trench crossing capability area, which makes it seem like a bad vehicle on the battlefields of the World War.
Right.
But then again, the Western Front is over 700 kilometers long. You have many terrains which are rather flat,
which have
hard ground, hard mud, not many obstacles. And whenever the A7V was used on this terrain, it performed very well.
Okay.
It has great top speed, 12 kilometers
per
hour.
I was just going to ask about speed and
12 kilometers, so it's pretty
that's on
speedy
roads,
for
right?
it.
That's on
and flat surface in general, so flat terrain, so meadows or whatever you have, that's okay. They get their speed up. They have quite the overview of the battlefield.
Okay.
Internally, they are very well equipped to be commanded very well in the field. They have tactical overview. They can communicate very well in this tank.
Yeah.
So whenever they were not used in the heaviest shelled ground, when they were used in areas where they're, as we say in German, panzergünstig, tank suited,
okay.
they performed very well.
Okay.
As I said, what they didn't do was crossing Flanders Field, crossing through really shelled mud.
Yeah.
They were useless there. That's true.
Now, what kind of armor did these guys have?
You mean in millimeters?
Yeah, but sure.
It's hardened steel. It's nothing spectacular. And you have 30 millimeters in the front and 50 millimeters at the sides, which is frontal, pretty much indestructible for smaller field guns.
Yeah.
If you get a full artillery, this can single blob like every tank.
Yeah.
And it's impregnable for
machine guns
with core ammunition.
I didn't know that that the smaller field guns couldn't do it. That was interesting. I like
only the front plate.
Yeah, I got that. Well, I mean, in their world, ideally, they're coming towards you when you're shooting at them.
Yes,
so.
Indeed.
Now, so these first went into action with Operation Michael, right? On March 21st,
yes.
1918. Now, can you tell us about the crew and the armaments and in the interior? Should we go take a look?
Yes,
and see what? Okay.
Yes,
come on, let's go take a look. Okay, now we're inside the A7V, and the first thing that strikes me, having been inside the Mark IV when we were at the Tank Museum Bovington, is this just as it is now, not during battle or with smoke and with people firing at you, this is a lot less of a claustrophobic feeling. However, what was the size of the crew of this?
The crew size in this tank was about 18 to 23, depending on the missions. So.
Okay, you see the size of this space. Now imagine that you're driving this, and there's the engine smoke and the noise, and everybody's half naked, and two guys threw up because they get car sick because they've never been in a car before, and people are firing machine guns and artillery at you. I can imagine it being extremely claustrophobic.
Extremely. And for example, you have, again, 60 cans of ammunition everywhere. You sit on ammunition, you have it all around. You have 15,000 bullets in here, just
wow.
for the machine guns. We have six machine guns.
Six machine guns.
And one main gun. And then you right. get into the crew. The main gun has three persons
okay.
operating it. So you, me, and a third guy just on this gun.
Okay, yeah, because I was going to say, why such a big crew? Why so many people?
Three there. Then you have a machine gun.
Yeah.
Two guys, one gunner, one loader.
One loader, and so that's 12.
So 15 right now.
Yeah.
So the commander and the driver up there.
Yeah.
This is actually the engine. They're sitting on the engine.
Okay, have fun.
No compartment at all. Everything is getting out, getting in. Fumes,
yeah.
heat, the noise. So what have you, 12, 15, 16, 17?
Yeah.
You have two mechanics.
Okay.
Because you have two engines.
Oh yeah, right, yeah.
200 horsepower engines, Daimler. So we are at 19 right now, right?
Yeah.
Then you get the boy for the officer, oftentimes, his
yeah.
personal adjutant. You got the pigeons guy.
Of course you need your
you
pigeons
have pigeons.
Guy. I'm sure the pigeons loved it in here.
You got one or two runners.
Yeah.
Sometimes you got a guy for the light signal, which you use to communicate with other tanks.
I mean, I can't believe they actually all got in yeah. here and could do stuff.
And sometimes you even have some kind of infantry detachment there. One, two
oh,
guys.
Oh, just so we're going to hop out. Okay.
And then you got your personal machine gun, which you have to carry with you if you have to disembark to defend.
So everybody has a machine gun as well?
No, you have one machine gun for the whole crew.
For the whole crew.
But you have the, of course, you have your rifles.
Yeah, sure.
Your pistols, your personal equipment.
Yeah.
So it's up to here.
I'm surprised there's not a guy playing drums just to make
yes,
it really
just
surreal.
Just to get the mood up, yes. But actually the Germans solved this problem quite good because in this tank you couldn't communicate at all.
Oh, right, sure.
I could scream in your ear, but then just the tiny bit would come at your ear. They had two clever devices in this tank to make communication possible. Over the machine gun you see a little device, yes, one white field with the writing Achtung, which
yeah.
means attention, and one red field with a Feuer in German. So the commander had direct connection to each weapon station, to each machine gun and to the main gun to tell them to be either ready to fire or to stop firing, which is ridiculously advanced for the First World War.
Yeah.
And they even went one step further. The commander at his place had some kind of aiming device. It's a tablet with an arrow and gratings. And if he from his point saw some noteworthy aim, he could show the way on this this device.
And via
this cables, at the same device at the gun, the gunner would see where to aim the gun. He still would have to find it, but he had the raw direction, rough direction to find the enemy the commander wanted to be engaged.
That's really advanced.
Yeah. On the other hand, this gun has a quite good optics on it. With a magnification, you can aim theoretically for over 4 kilometers.
Okay.
The crews hated it because the suspension on this tank is minimal. This thing is waving up, down all the time. So if you have your eye on an optic, you just go up, down meters and you don't see anything.
The first
four guns had just simple aiming over the barrel and they wanted it back.
Yeah.
Every unit with A7V made a formal writing, we want these old guns back, but they didn't get it. The Germans always want the most complex engineering, so they got this.
Can you tell us about, you talked about the suspension.
Yes.
Can you tell us about the Caterpillar trucks that this is?
Yes, yes indeed. When the Germans decided to build tanks, they wanted it now and they wanted it in big numbers. So they decided they wanted to build with proven components. They wanted things that worked.
Right.
They had ridiculously propositions from the industry, like the tanks with small feet revolving and stuff like that.
Oh, that would have been so cool just to see.
Yes, yes, yes. Star Wars style sometimes,
yeah,
really.
Okay.
You can see ridiculous
walkers. Yeah.
But yeah, they decided we wanted a track system because it was known track systems work in the field.
You saw in the British. Yes.
But in the German Empire, although industrious, there were no vehicles with track systems. They were
no
not
farms,
used.
No, nothing.
So they decided, okay, we have to find something and use it. And the Austro-Hungarians, by coincidence, showed a Caterpillar hauled track vehicle at a fair in Berlin at this time. So
just one,
fair. Look what tractor. We have. So they got it. And they decided, okay, we use this in the A7V. First problem was they didn't know how. So they needed the original driver from Budapest, an Hungarian, to come up to Berlin to work for them. I don't know if they convinced him, paid him, or forced him, I don't know. So he had to show how it works. And then they decided to actually pay the license fees to Caterpillar Holt.
So these were Holt, they weren't their own version of...
Their own version, but the patent was paid for by
license
fees.
Indeed. And they paid them?
They paid.
Oh, that's good. Capitalism.
Yes.
War does not stop for capitalism.
The A7V has a reputation to be a crude design, but if you look at it, there are small solutions to many problems which are very clever, actually. One thing that's often forgotten is that this design is by intention. The armor is sloped, so the thickness is not the only factor. The sloped armor leads to the fact that the incoming bullets of the enemy glide off the armor sometimes, so the armor is more effective by the slope design. And another small detail is, for example, this door, or every door on this tank, is designed this way, that there are enforcements on the outside bolted on, so even if this door is hit by something, by shell or something, it won't be blown in because this grabs the door and holds it. And there are many this small solutions all over the design which shows that although the tank was designed very hurriedly in very few weeks actually, everything is well thought out.
All right, can you tell us about the main gun?
The main gun is, depending on who you ask, either Belgian, Swedish, Russian or English.
It's kind of like me.
Yeah, and it's true to varying degrees. So the gun design was built in Great Britain, in London, by Maxim Nordenfeld company. Nordenfeld himself was Swedish, so that's where this comes from. And this gun was sold to Belgium and Russia. So when the Germans invaded Belgium, they captured these guns in big numbers because they were for fortresses, and so they captured them and hauled them back to Germany. And when the A7V was designed, there was the need of a gun, of course. They wanted male A7Vs, to speak in the English terminology. So they used this gun because the recoil is very short.
Uh-huh.
The gun has two cylinders, so it's not one long recoil, but rather short. Actually, they wanted to build in the 7.7 centimeter German field gun, but that's what much too bulky, too long recoil. So they chose that. And the Russian thing is, when the Germans made peace with the Russians, they also got some of these Russian London guns.
Yeah.
And then there's a language barrier. These guns are in German, Sockellafette, which is in English, pedestal or sockel.
Okay.
And the Russian company for guns, Sokol. So there came some confusion because it's a 5.7 centimeter gun from Russia on a Sokol, something like that. So depending on which books you look, there you have it.
Okay. Up at the top of the tank, just standing from here and having a look, it doesn't look like you have very much line of sight. Like, you can't see here.
Indeed, that's true, that's true. The concept of the A7 with the turret on top is a mixed bag, so to say. On the one hand, you have great overview.
Okay, oh, okay.
Far seeing, you can see everything. You can see machine gun nests over 20, 50, 100 meters. But you actually can't see anything that's right in front
of you. Right in front of your face.
You have a blind angle of 9 meters. Even the machine guns have a blind angle of about 4 meters. So, let's say if you, like we are standing, you can't really see us if you're sitting up there. So the driver and the commander always have to have the far view and overview everything.
Well, that's really cool. Well, let's talk a little bit about the operational history. First, now, there's only 20 of these were actually made in production. Now, the Germans also had the Beutepanzer, which was the captured, like, Mark IVs and things like that. Indeed. And there were a lot more of those.
Yes, indeed.
Now, why did they do that? Why did they not make more of these? Why would they rather use recycled British or French tanks?
Because they weren't very much impressed. The reason you mostly hear is they had some kind of technophobia. They didn't like modern technology. They were sworn to courage and gallantry and horses and stuff. That's nonsense. You see, the German army is highly technologized.
They
have guns and everything. In October 1916, they were processing the Somme battle, the first engagement with the British tanks.
Sure.
And the first reaction they had was, build them now, build them in masses.
Okay.
The Prussian Minister of War and the German High Command, the both important players in the field, both said, you can see it in the sources, build it now, build it in masses. And 4 months later, they are,
Not so impressed.
Not so impressed.
Not even after, it wasn't
Cambrai,
it's
later, right.
16,
So what happened was, there was this, in German, Tankschreck, a tank shock, tank fear. They were impressed, of course they were, but then again, they quickly saw, okay, they break down. They get stuck, we can destroy them. They are slow, they don't see very much. Actually, we can handle it.
Okay.
So when the German High Command got these reports, they said, okay, let's think what we can do with our scarce resources. That's the next point. The Germans were behind the blockade. They don't have many resources, iron, everything was scarce. So there are these machines that are not working very well, and there's the German Kriegsmarine, the Navy, saying, if we can build U-boats, submarines, which need exactly the same stuff like tanks, we can strangle Great Britain and end the war.
Yeah.
So it was very sound to say, okay, do this,
well, because,
the marked tanks, we can stop them, no problem.
Yeah.
And also they said, but we have to keep in mind there's something going on there. So build this crude thing you have designed in just 3 months. The A7 redesigns were there. I said, build it, you don't get high priority on the resources, you have to work with limited resources, and we will always harass you with new ideas, but keep on working, but on a low level.
Okay.
Because best case, we win until the end of the year.
Right.
So the next step was Cambrai.
Yeah.
So now they were thinking, okay, this seems to work. But then again, Cambrai was...
The counterattack was great.
The counterattack was great.
So.
Yeah, they were seeing, okay, we got the area back very quickly. But then again, they were spread blood. They didn't have this many casualties. That's nice for us. That's especially nice for us because we don't have so vast human resources.
Right.
So they give a little more resources to the A7 redevelopment, but still they are not really committed. They're not dedicated. They just build it and let's see what happens. And then, in the beginning of 1918, we're getting through the operational history now. In the beginning of 1918, the first units of A7Vs are ready. You have 3 units with 5 tanks each, and 1 reserve unit. So the first thing is, we need people. We have now the machines, so we need people. What they do? Volunteers. Give us volunteers. They make advertisements and they get the volunteers. They get artillerymen for the gun. They get infantrists for the machine guns. They get drivers for the driving seat. And people come, they want to serve with the tanks because longer rest, less work, interesting work field, chance for promotion, chance for decoration.
Not marching 10 kilometers.
Yes, correct. Much time on the road, railroads, so you're much on trains.
Oh, yeah. So
the people flow in, and then they have to be forged into a unit. So the first thing they have to do is just to train together. And the Germans never established a real tank corps. They never had a real corps d'esprit, the idea of being a team, of being a distinct branch. They were just people thrown together with a great energy and some vehicles, but they were just a band of people. So they were given to the leader course, the thing that every soldier had to run through, the course to get to be a real frontline soldier in France. And there they just have infantry training to grow together. And then they get the machines. And at this point, nobody has any idea what to do with the tanks.
All right, no doctrine.
No doctrine, anything. The Supreme Army Command says, take the tanks and go to this course where you learn how to fight. And the people at the course are normally training infantrymen say, okay, let's try. We do what we always do, just with tanks.
Just with tanks. So, yeah.
And this works out kind of. The idea, if the units after 3 weeks are operational or not, is heavily debated. Ludendorff says they're not operational. They don't do anything special.
Right.
Hauptmann Rohr, the founder of the Sturmtruppen, the master tactician of his time, said, yes, they are. Again, given the right ground, given the right area, given the right objective,
right,
then they will work out just fine. And the operational history later exactly proves this point.
Right.
The A7V is on the battlefield several times, sometimes one unit, only once all three together. And they win and lose with the same number. So sometimes they perform very well.
Yeah.
Some even, or especially when the ground is perfect for them, they sometimes outrun the infantry, make storming attacks, and personally gather hundreds of prisoners,
yeah,
which surrender to this tank.
This thing.
Which actually can't see them if they stand
yeah
here.
Yeah.
So, but
hello,
it works.
Hello,
yeah,
hello.
And other times, they get stuck in the mud, like the Mark tanks, before they attack, they get lost in the fog.
Yeah, like during Georgette, when they were...
Yes, sometimes it's depressing. Sometimes they...
Didn't they have to blow some of them?
They did, and sometimes they topple over.
Oh, okay.
But then again, that's the same with the French and the British tanks.
Yeah.
One important thing is they never made any operational impact because they're just 15 plus reserves.
Mm-hmm.
And the point is, kind of heartbreaking, everybody knew it. Because these guys weren't dumb. They knew, okay, we are fighting here, but we won't make the big difference.
No.
And it was so secret, the German tanks were so secret, that in one case, one A7V tank was actually so fast, he lost touch with the infantry. Then he got lost in the fog.
Okay.
Lost orientation and attacked a Bavarian trench because he rotated completely. The Bavarians, on the other hand, have never heard of their own tanks. So what they do? They open fire. Oh. Only thanks to incompetence on both sides,
war is
nothing
hell
happens. Yeah, but you see, the A7Vs, even for the Germans, they were not like in Great Britain, these tremendous propaganda instruments.
Oh yeah, sure.
No way.
Yeah, this is gonna win. This is it. This is the thing.
No, yeah. Signed war loans in this tank on the marketplace. Nothing of that.
So, oh, and the tank, you know, handbags.
The piggy banks and everything. Are, yeah.
God, I'd love to have one of those.
In Germany, even if you decided to be a tank driver in Germany and you got into the training, the first tank you ever saw was at the front because in Germany you had to train on normal lorries.
Yeah, of course.
So there you maybe got one, or better chance you get on the captured tanks. So the Germans captured great numbers of tanks, 180 mostly British tanks they captured, and used for their own Beutepanzerabteilung, so captured tanks units.
Yeah.
They liked them. But again, they even had them and still not decided to copy them because they were not impressed.
That's
only changed radically in August 1918. The Black Day, 8th of August 1918, the Black Day of the German Army, there came the point where everything changed. And then they decided, okay, we need many tanks, we need light tanks, we need thousands of tanks, and then peace broke out.
I like it. Peace broke out. War breaks out and peace broke out. Well, that was fascinating. Thank you very much for taking the time to talk to us. And
of course,
been a lot of fun coming here today. And now you guys have a YouTube channel of your own.
Yes, we do. Sadly, strictly German. We can't do it internationally.
But I'll tell you what.
Yes.
I can link these people to one of your German episodes so that
thank you very much.
German. Which one would you like us to link to?
You should choose the Merkava, the Israeli tank. Very fascinating thing.
Okay, well, if you want to see that, you can click right here for that episode. And do not forget to subscribe, and we will see you next time and every time.